I spent a couple of weeks, burned through half a spool of filament, and went through 13 separate iterations just to make this, a completely custom snap-fit battery holder. Why bother? Because those generic black boxes you buy online, they don't fit your projects, the wires snap off, and they look boring. Today, I'm going to show you the entire workflow, how to design it in FreeCAD, the slicer settings for perfect fits, and how to wire it up without melting the plastic. Let's go. All of the files, the FreeCAD source, the STLs, the Cura profiles, they are all free on GitHub, link in the description. But first, I have a massive favor to ask. If you learn even one new trick in this video, please hit that like and subscribe button. It genuinely helps the channel keep going. And please drop a comment. I read them all. Your feedback dictates exactly what I build next. Okay, look at this junk. This is what we're replacing. Bulky, wrong shape, wires that are too short. Today, we build our own version. First, the weapon of choice. I'm dusting off my old Creality CR10 Mini. It's an older Ender-style machine, and it's been sitting for months. In 3D printing, a dormant printer is probably a miscalibrated printer. We can't just hit print. I ran the paper test to level the bed. It was a disaster. The center was bowed up, classic warped bed syndrome. I had to do a full 5-point manual calibration corners and center just to get a decent first layer. Next step, the holy water, isopropyl alcohol. See that fingerprint? That's oil. That means your print will detach halfway through and create spaghetti. Scrub it clean until it squeaks. To prove the machine is dialed in, I reprinted the keychain from my previous video. If you haven't seen that tutorial, check the link in the corner. It came out glass smooth, so we are clear for takeoff. We need measurements. But watch out. Never, ever use metal calipers to measure a battery's height. You bridge the positive and negative, you create a dead short, the battery gets hot, and you ruin your calipers. Use a ruler for the height. We are looking at about 49 millimeters tall and 14 millimeters wide. For the contacts, calipers are fine. We've got a negative spring and a positive button. I'm designing the walls to be 2.25 millimeters thick. Why? Because PLA is brittle. Anything thinner than 2 millimeters on a functional part is just asking to crack when you change batteries. Here is the number one reason 3D prints don't fit together. If you draw a 10 millimeter hole for a 10 millimeter block, physics say numb. Plastic shrinks when it cools and it squishes when it prints. You have to design for tolerance. Loose fit, 0.4 millimeter gap, it rattles somewhat. Standard, 0.3 millimeter gap, good for pegs. Hammer fit, 0.1 millimeter gap. You literally need a hammer. We want the snug friction fit, about 0.2 millimeters to 0.3 millimeters clearance. Enough to snap the contact in, but tight enough that it won't fly out when you drop the case. Now, into FreeCAD. But I didn't print the whole case first. That's a bad move that wastes hours. I printed just the negative terminal slot. Small print, fast failure, rapid prototyping. Print one, garbage. The base was too narrow. The spring wouldn't even sit flat. Prints two, three, and four. I widened the walls, recentered the slot, and I overcompensated. I made the retention bridge too high. The battery wouldn't even touch the contact. Back to the drawing board. This was the Goldilocks zone. Print five was too tight. I had to use pliers to get the contact in. Print six was too loose. It fell out. But print seven, perfection. We found the retention height. We are ready to build the rest of the case. Now, we've spent a lot of time dialing in tolerances because home printers struggle with layer lines and accuracy. But sometimes you need a part that is stronger, smoother, and heat resistant. That's where today's sponsor, PCBWay, comes in. You know them for PCBs, but their 3D printing service is fantastic. You can take the STLs we just designed, upload them, and get them printed in industrial SLS nylon or resin. Later in this video, we are going to solder near PLA, which is risky because it can melt. PCBWay's nylon PA12 can handle much higher temps, making it perfect for custom electronics enclosures like this. Stop struggling with layer lines on final parts. Check out the link in the description to prototype with PCBWay. Okay, back to our print. Now for the housing. But again, I don't want to print a huge box just to find out the battery doesn't fit. I used a bullion cut to slice just a 10mm strip of the case. This lets me test the snap feel of the battery insertion in a 10-minute print. Print 8 proved the battery fit, technically, but it was sloppy. Print 9, I drilled down into the FreeCAD history, tightened the width, and boom, snug fit. Now we need a positive terminal. Why reinvent the wheel? I just duplicated the negative contact, rotated it 180 degrees, and stuck it on the other end. That gave us print 10. It looked great, but longitudinally, it was rattle city. The spring wasn't compressing enough to hold the battery tight. So for print 11, I shortened the entire case by 2mm. This forces the spring to compress, creating tension that locks the battery in place. Rock solid. But one battery is limiting. I wanted 3 volts and 5 volts. I duplicated the final design to create a 2-up and a 3-up version. But I didn't just place them side by side. I merged them so they share a single internal wall. This makes the case smaller and faster to print. You can ruin a perfect design with bad slicer settings. First, orient the case on its back. If you print it standing up, the layer lines will be parallel to the spring tension. The moment you put a battery in, the tab will snap right off. Print it flat for strength. Second, enable ironing. It runs the hot nozzle over the top layer one last time. It takes a little longer, but it makes the contact slots buttery smooth. No sanding required. Now, the scary part, combining hot solder with PLA plastic. PLA melts at 60 degrees Celsius. Your iron is 350 degrees. Do the math. For the 2-up and 3-up cases, we are wiring them in series to increase the voltage. I use copper tape to bridge the connections on the bottom. It's cleaner than wires, but it's fiddly. Rule number 1, tin your wires and tabs separately before you put them in the case. Once they're in the case, use the lickety-split method. Get in, melt the solder, get out. If you linger for too long, the heat travels down the metal tab and deforms the plastic housing. Game over. This is the Achilles heel of PLA. It softens at just 60 degrees Celsius. I used it for this video because it prints easily and is perfect for rapid prototyping. I didn't want to fight with warping during 13 iterations. But for your final build, I highly recommend switching to PETG or ABS. They are more durable, the snap fits will last longer, and crucially, they have much higher heat resistance. You can solder near them without the anxiety attack. So remember, prototype in PLA, production in PETG. Now, let's finish these connections. Wiring is done. Now, the moment of truth. Let's verify the numbers before we fry any chips. Single cell alkaline, 1.6 volts. 2 in series, 3.2 volts. 3 in series, 4.8 volts. The math checks out, but will they actually run a microcontroller? First, the 1-up holder. A standard alkaline won't cut it here, so I swapped in a 32V LiFePO 4 cell. Plugging it into the custom non-regulated ESP32C3 board I made in a previous video. Link in the corner. And it's perfect. It runs the board natively with zero issues. Next, the 2-up holder with standard alkalines. We're getting about 3.2 volts total. It powers the board for now. But here's the trap. As these batteries drain, they're going to drop below 3 volts very quickly. Since this board isn't regulated, you're going to hit a brownout way faster than you want. It works, but I wouldn't trust it for long missions. That is why we built the 3-up version. 3 cells give us nearly 5 volts. This provides plenty of overhead for the onboard voltage regulator on this XIAO ESP32. It's stable, reliable, and exactly what we wanted. 13 iterations. A pile of scrap PLA, which I really need to figure out how to recycle in a future video. But we did it. A custom, reliable power supply that costs cents to print. I know I moved fast. If you want the step-by-step photos, the wiring diagrams, and the full troubleshooting guide, I wrote a massive article on my website. Scan this QR code or click the link below. The dream is to eventually take this FreeCAD model and make it parametric, so you could just type in AAA or 18650 and the design auto-generates. I haven't built that yet, But if that is a tutorial you really want to see, let me know in the comments. If enough people ask for it, I'll bump it up the list. Check out the keychain video here to master your first layer, or the ESP32 project here. Thanks for watching, and keep making.